Assistant Director for Policy and External Affairs at the McSilver Institute and Community Technical Assistance Center of New York. It's my privilege this morning to welcome you on behalf of the Department of Health, the Office of Children and Family Services, IPRO, and the New York Care Coordination Program to the webinar, talking about voluntary foster care agency opportunities for technical assistance as we head into Medicaid managed care for the behavioral health system in New York State. So again, we have quite a robust agenda and quite a few presentations, but for anyone looking at the 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. time frame and being a little bit nervous about the amount of time we've got, we've allotted plenty of time on the tail end for Q&A. So with that in mind, I just wanted to talk through a few logistics and tech details. So all of the participants on the phone right now are muted. And so for questions, we encourage people to use the chat box on the right side of the screen at the bottom and send those in throughout the webinar. We will most likely just be continuing on through the presentations unless some urgent matters or issues come up that we can address just off the top. But again, we'll have plenty of time at the end to loop back around to any questions that are coming through throughout. For any tech questions that come up, you can send a chat to who's listed as Amanda Alcantara, the host of the webinar, who is actually Morgan McGuire, who I'd like to give a quick shout out to and thank her for all of her work on the back end with the logistics and the tech for today's webinar. So the objectives for today for folks, so we're going to be providing an overview of healthcare reform initiatives and the changes that are anticipated in the children's system of care. As folks probably noticed and heard, if you're on this webinar, the implementation timeline for Medicaid managed care shifted a couple of weeks ago, which also allowed for us to change the kickoff series and the leadership forum approach where we'd previously thought of doing in-person, longer format events, which we've, you know, for I think everyone's sake, consolidated into a single webinar where we can really share information and get it out to the entire state and all at once instead of in separate pieces. There's a lot of important information we'll be covering today, so again, we're so glad that you've joined us. We'll be describing the technical assistance that will be available to voluntary foster care agencies. A little bit later on into the webinar, we'll be presenting and releasing the results of the readiness assessment that the participating agencies for this project completed and sent in to us. And then we'll be previewing how agencies will use these readiness assessment results, their individual results, to create their strategic plan and work plans for organizational change moving forward. So just a very quick look at the agenda. After I'm done with a few last opening remarks, I'll be turning it over to Lana Earle, the Deputy Director at the New York State Department of Health, Division of Program Development and Management, Office of Health Insurance Programs, and Laura Velez, who's the Deputy Commissioner for OCFS, the Child Welfare and Community Services. Following them, Terry Greco from IPRO, she's the Project Director there, will be talking about the project in more generally and introducing some of the TA that will be ongoing and a timeline for how this all looks. A health homes technical assistance overview will be provided by Adele Gorgeous, who's the executive director of the New York Care Coordination Program, with John Lee, who's the director there as well. I'll be back on in a little while to talk about the readiness assessment results and technical assistant training and the resources that will be made available to OCFS voluntary agencies. And then, saving the best for last, we'll be talking about the foster care grants and application process that'll be coming out in the next month or so. And then, like I mentioned, by that point, we've set aside, you know, no less than half an hour at the tail end for discussion and questions and answers. So with that, I am happy to turn it over to Lana and Laura.
process, and we look forward to working with the voluntary foster care agencies on our rather ambitious agenda. I think there's a fair amount of excitement around what we're trying to do for the children's system of care as well as for foster care. And I think that I'm really continue to be happy and honored to be working with the voluntary foster care agencies, because I really do think that we have an incredible opportunity here before us, which also always comes with opportunity, always comes with incredible amounts of work. I think that was instilled upon me as a child, and it has been true ever since, and I'm well past the child. So with that, we'll go ahead and advance to the next slide. And I just want to take a couple of minutes to just provide a quick overview. I don't know. Oh, there we go. Are we advancing to the next slide? There we go. Again. Okay. Sorry. So I think folks have seen this slide. I know Greg spent some time with CAFSA last week, and I think this was one of the slides that he went through as well. Just to really step back for a moment and talk about some of those opportunities that we are creating, and then to kind of focus a little bit on the timeline, because as mentioned in the beginning, it's changed a little bit. The whole MRT initiative really is focused on a couple of very key points that I think are salient to all that we're doing. And so, just taking a step back a moment to look to see how the pieces fit together is kind of what I'd like to do in the next couple of slides. Clearly, we have a primary objective within the whole MRT design to provide care management to children. And there's vehicles for doing that. One, of course, is health homes. Key to all of that we're doing, really starting with the health home model and its integrated network, but also moving towards benefits, moving from fee-for-service to managed care under the umbrella of managed care for all, integrating the delivery of physical and behavioral health services, obviously very key and a big part of what we're doing, and particularly for foster care, moving the foster care children under the umbrella of managed care as well. Key to what we really want to do, right, is identify and address needs early to prevent escalation and longer-term need for higher-end services. You know, this is just the key theme that whenever we are thinking about where we're going, I always look to that one because I think that is the key to what will be a successful unveiling of all of these initiatives if we can continue to keep focused on that and make sure we're achieving that goal. And then, obviously, the goal of always maintaining the child in the community and at home with support services whenever possible and improving our abilities to do that. So with those key objectives, you know, how do we go ahead and implement them? Obviously, starting very soon, this October, with the enrollment of children in health homes. And I know this group has been very active in attending our webinars that we've had on health homes for children. In the April 29th one, there was one, I think, this week also on user cases for assignment enrollment. So the design and the development is growing, and there's lots of information out there. And so those will continue alongside the health home training that New York Care Coordination Program will be providing to you as well. The other thing that we want to do, and Laura will take charge of this later in the presentation, but is to expand Medicaid state plan services. That's really just getting to the third and fourth goal on the left side of our page. So that's very important. And I think what we'd like to try to do is move forward with that piece of the agenda as soon as possible. So hopefully that is happens in between the October 2015 enrollment of children and then the transition of managed care in January in New York City and Long Island, in July in the rest of the state. And the only thing I didn't touch on in the bubble on the right is just the expanded array of HCBS services, really key to accentuating and helping out with the services that will be wrapped around children and also in the care planning that health homes will do. So health homes is really, I think, teed up in October to then kind of embrace the availability of those HCBS services come 2017. And then, of course, the shift of the waiver programs that will come also in 2017. And with that, we can go to the next slide. So I think I've really touched on this, but, you know, just reminding folks that I think it was in 2011 or maybe end of 2010, the MRT notion of care management for all. And so how does that unfold itself? And certainly, you know, it can be in a variety of ways, and I think we'll see the variety of those ways as we think about how we provide care management to children. But patient-centered medical homes with the primary care focus, you know, has been around and is a model that exists out there today. Clearly, health homes, given its eligibility criteria, will really begin to capture, and in particular, folks in the voluntary, or excuse me, folks in foster care who would meet the eligibility criteria for health homes and need that intensive level of care management. And then there's just obviously care management that's provided through the plans themselves. And then, as folks know, there's also the HCBS care management that will come in 2017. So there's a variety of ways for us to provide care management. I think probably the foster care children will either touch health home, or, and if they're not appropriate for health home in that level of intensity, probably some other level listed on the page. With that, we can go to the next slide. And just to remind folks, you know, the first key initiative to be implemented is health homes upcoming. And I think I know this group, again, has been very engaged, but just to remind folks, you know, we have been working over the past year with the state agency partners, COFCA, the voluntary foster care agencies, and various presentations and webinars to design the health home model for children, expanding the health home eligibility criteria, in particular for the foster care folks, to include the proposed criteria of trauma at risk for another condition. We're incorporating the modified CANs, we're developing health home rates for children, we're tailoring the six core health home services to the needs of the child and family, the referral and assignment process that I've talked about and we had a most recent webinar on. And just to drill down quickly to this audience, the whole entire model was really built around and with special attention to foster care, and really provided a key role for the local departments of social services as well as the voluntary foster care agencies. And in that role, ensuring that the voluntary foster care agencies are the entity that provides the care management for children enrolled in health homes, and that the LDSS, we recognize them in their care and custody role in terms of providing consent and referring and assigning children to voluntary foster care agencies that are engaged to provide with health homes for providing care management. So a real key important role. And throughout the process of the design and the webinars, you know, this role has been captured and discussed. And I think as part of the health home training, one of the key things that we'll begin to focus on is the role of the case planners and the role of the health home care managers, and how do we work together collectively to make those roles clear and what's the best way to implement the model. And so that will happen through some of these trainings and also through continued discussions with the Department of Health, OCFS, and COFCA and other foster care agencies. So we look forward to all of that work, and again, remain excited about the path before us and the opportunities that we see. Going on to the next slide. This is just, everyone has seen it, it's the famous agenda. So we'll get, it's just highlighting again our October enrollment date for children in health homes, and then where we are now with the behavioral health transition and the other changes that will happen in the managed care side of the world. The next real juncture here is for us to continue to provide training, which obviously we're doing here today, and we'll do through the Department of Health as well. And the application review process that's underway, and that juncture deadline is mid-June for us, and so we're continuing to work towards that. Next slide. So this, again, is just a little segue into we're starting out with health homes. Health Home will provide a care management to a wider array of children. If folks saw the April 29th webinar, you know, our estimates of art and science suggest that over time, approximately 175,000 children could be eligible for Health Home, and which portion of those folks might meet the appropriateness criteria. And again, I think the Health Home model that will launch in October really will provide a structure for managing the additional array of state plan services that we're working on, as well as the integration of those physical and behavioral health services as we move the behavioral health services into managed care and those HCBS services. So those are all three new tools and environments that will come after the implementation of the Health Home model and will help accentuate the delivery of care management under the Health Home model. And so we like the idea here of launching Health Home prior to all the transitions that will happen in 2017. And going to the next slide, I'm going to turn it over to my colleague Laura Velez to walk through some of the state plan services.
Thank you, Lana. Good morning, everybody. It's wonderful to see so many people in attendance on this webinar. We're noting that the number is up to 192, so that's really terrific. So the slide related to the proposed new state plan services is one that I think most of you have seen before. What this really does is it shows the state's intent to go beyond the traditional state plan services that are currently part of the Medicaid benefit. So we're looking at crisis intervention and specifically thinking about mobile crisis services that will be billable under Medicaid. The community psychiatric supports and treatment addition includes things like evidence-based therapies that many of our providers have been interested in providing but didn't have a funding stream to attach them to. And so this provides the state with the opportunity to enhance those kinds of services. Other licensed practitioners, again, goes beyond what our traditional billable services have been. The psychosocial rehab services are skill building kinds of services that some of you are familiar with. We're very excited to see family peer support and youth peer advocacy and training included in the benefit package because this provides an avenue for those kinds of supports that we know many of our family and youth need. They're fairly low level, and we believe that by adding these into the state plan amendment that we will be able to increase the capacity and the scope of these services all across the state and make them available to more families and more children. As Lana said earlier, we're hoping to receive CMS approval for these new state plan services in advance of 2017. And should that happen, then the care managers through the Health Home will have the ability to coordinate these services as well as the existing ones. I think one of the important notes here is that by adding these services, we are also creating some new business opportunities across the state among our various providers because, as I said earlier, these don't really exist in any with any real volume at this point, and so we're going to need to increase our capacity, and people should be thinking about how to do that, where to do that, with whom they would like to partner with in order to get these services available to our kids and families. Next slide. So again, a review. The existing Medicaid services will transition to to managed care in 2017. I think we're really trying to make the point here that there are two separate and distinct activities going on. One is Health Home phase in starting in October of this year, and the Medicaid managed care transition is 2 years from now. And that will include the OMH residential treatment facilities, the waiver services under OMH, OCFS, and the Department of Health, and then, as you know, the services that are currently paid under the foster care per diem. All will be transitioned into managed care in 2017. Next. Again, a review, because I imagine that most of you have seen these before. These are a compilation of the various services that are currently funded through the respective waivers. So you'll see the services that are included under the Bridges to Health waiver from OCFS. You'll see the Care at Home services added into this list, as well as the services that are currently provided under the OMH waiver. Our view was to take all of those different services, package them together. That way, all of the children who are currently being serviced through our waivers will continue to get the services that they need. Next. This diagram shows what the health home model is for children, and you will note that at the top, when we move into the managed care environment, that the MCOs are first. They will be the contract holders with the health homes. And then under the health homes, we have the six core services showing the types of care coordination that need to be provided. On the right-hand side, there are the care managers serving children. And again, noting that it will be required that the health homes contract with the foster care agencies to be the downstream providers for care management for the children in foster care. And then on the left side, you see the model showing the care manager serving the adults with all of the different bubbles beneath indicating what the networks need to look like. So clearly, we'll need the pediatric health care providers. You're going to be serving the OMH TCM kids, the different waiver children, et cetera. So the box below really shows what the network is going to need to look like and how this access has to be provided. And there's a list of all of the different services included in that. The next slide. I think all of you have seen the bubbles in this diagram of more than once, but just to quickly review it, it shows that the managed care model that we are proposing has the MCOs containing the full benefit package, that it will include all of the health and pharmacy and expanded benefits. It will include all of the behavioral health services, and then it will also include all of the new HCBS services that were listed in the previous slides. Underneath that, it really reflects the care management for all philosophy, so whether that's provided by a health home or by the plan, all kids who need care management will receive it. The MCOs will be required to contract with those entities listed in the blue bubbles, so you'll see things that are familiar to you. Pediatric healthcare and specialty providers, obviously, community-based providers, foster care providers, behavioral health providers, all of the providers that currently serve children. We're also looking for the plans to be developing MOUs or working relationships with some of the non-traditional entities, school districts, the juvenile justice and criminal justice systems that serve children, the local governmental units and the SPOAs, all of these folks that currently work closely with children in communities and design services for them are all entities that need to be closely aligned with the plans. Next slide. So now I'm going to turn this over to IPRO because they will be discussing in more detail the collaboration between IPRO, the Department of Health, and OCFS. IPRO has been responsible for working with all of us and all of you on the managed care readiness activities, and they will be really focusing on the training, the work and the analysis around what we learned from the readiness surveys that you all completed and where we need to go forward from there. So at this point, I'd like to turn it over to IPRO.
Thank you, Laura. So good morning, everyone. This is Terry Greco. I just want to say that we are just so pleased to be working with such a committed group of state partners and professional organizations on this important initiative. IPRO holds multiple contracts with federal, state, and local governments, and our goals are always to foster improved healthcare outcomes for patients across systems and throughout the life cycle. If we go to the next slide, I introduced you to our project partners during our kickoff webinar back in February. We can advance to the next slide for just a review of those project partners. Empire Health Advisors has been engaged to conduct data collection and analysis. The New York Care Coordination Program has been engaged to conduct health home training, and you'll be hearing more about that this morning. Ray Shimmer has been engaged as our foster care subject matter expert, and the Community Technical Assistance Center of New York at NYU McSilver Institute for Poverty Policy and Research has been engaged to conduct several of the activities that we're involved in right now, including the readiness assessment, which we've already completed, offering technical assistance and managed care training coming in 2016 and beyond as we move towards transition. I wanted to spend just a few minutes updating everyone on the data collection activities. I know when we met in February, some agencies had expressed an interest in understanding more about how the data collection activities were being conducted. So I wanted to just talk with you a little bit about the goal of the data collection activities, which is that they would inform the development of the rates for the managed care premium and the development of the residual foster care per diem. The sampling methodology and data collection tools were developed through a combined effort of a multi-agency work group that included representatives from the Department of Health, Office of Health Insurance Programs and Division for Rate Setting, the Office of Children and Family Services, Chapin Hall, Mercer, Empire Health Advisors, and IPRO's subject matter expert. The work group recognized the importance of drawing a sample that would be reflective of the population as a whole, as well as to take into account the unique needs of the children served and wide array of services provided. Therefore, a child-centric approach was used. Previous work that had been done by Chapin Hall suggested that a child's behavioral health history prior to placement was an important variable in their total cost of care. The sample selection took this variable into account. Additional variables included the age of the child, the facility type, the facility size, and the region. Within these strata, children were selected at random. In the next slide, you can see that over 600 children's records were selected, encompassing the involvement of 26 agencies. The records included a medical record review, a review of connections data, activity studies engaged by 12 additional agencies, and a review of the Medicaid claims data. The agencies selected for the activity study represent the various sizes and locations of agencies throughout the state. These activities are nearing completion. If you go to the next slide, you'll see the overall project development. Some of the activities we've already completed. As you can see, the data collection activities are anticipated to be completed by the end of the month. We've completed these compilation of survey results culminating in today's leadership forum, and technical assistance and training will be beginning now and ongoing straight through enrollment into health homes in 2015 and through transition in 2017. So with that, I would like to introduce one of our project partners, NYCCP, Adele Gorgeous, and John Lee, who will talk with you more about the training offerings for health homes for children.
Good morning.
Good morning as well.
We're happy to have an opportunity to discuss with you what will be offered in terms of the information that you might need in order to be ready to be a health home care management agency. That will include providing you with information and answering your questions. We have put together an outline that we hope will be comprehensive. If you notice big missing pieces, which we hope we have covered it all, but if you do, please let us know so that we can take care of that. Next slide, please. So this is a tentative schedule of what the technical assistance will be comprised of. It's an overview followed by an administrative track, a care manager track, and then some post-go-live activities. We'll go through these in a little more detail. Next slide. The overview is the webinar that you're on today. So those of you who are on it will have a check mark there. For the administrative track, this is geared specifically for your agency leadership team. It will address the business aspects of health home care management. And then there's a care manager track, which is going to be geared for care management supervisors and care managers. And anyone from the administrative track who feels that it would be beneficial for them to participate in that, it would be great to have you as a part of this. Next slide. The administrative track. This will be four different webinars, once a month, starting in May and going through August. We can talk about the outcomes that we're looking for each of those particular webinars. Next slide. The first topic to be covered is what it means to be a downstream provider. For some of you, that may not be a term you've heard before. The structure of health homes includes first an organization which has applied for and been designated by the Department of Health to provide health home care management services. This organization holds the medallion and they are referred to as the health home. The health home will typically also be a direct provider of care management services, but they won't typically be the only provider of care management services for their health home. They would contract with various downstream providers who will actually provide the care management services. Voluntary foster care agencies are in that category of a downstream care management agency, which actually subcontracts with a designated health home to provide the needed services. Next slide. The second administrative topic is quality assurance and outcomes management. The learning objectives are first to understand what the outcomes are that the Department of Health is looking for from the work of the health homes. To some extent, you may find that these are different than the outcomes that you had previously been held accountable for. The second item would be understanding how the health homes process and outcome measures are tracked and reported. Who tracks it, who will it be reported to, and what will be the covered topics. We'll also need to be sure that you have a firm understanding of what the key elements are of a successful health home quality assurance program, which is one of the responsibilities of a downstream provider. You'll need to understand the use of the audit tools, which will be provided and required by not only the health homes and the Department of Health, but also the managed care organizations have some items that they will be auditing for on a regular basis. And then lastly, and very importantly, the resources that are available to the health homes and the downstream providers to actually develop a quality assurance program. Next slide. The third administrative topic will be finance and billing, with a goal of understanding what is billable under health home care management, how that care management billing will actually take place, and importantly for the downstream providers, how will you receive payment for the services that you have provided. We'll look to have you understand all the documentation requirements that are tied to that billing, as well as to various regulatory categories. And then finally, how to develop financial projections for your agency, and how to understand what your revenue streams will be, and what types of expenses you might look to be incurring, and the important variable, which is the caseload for the individuals being served and the associated rates. Topic number four for administrative track is policies and procedures. It is required that there be a policy and procedure manual for each of the health homes, and that goes downstream to the downstream care management agencies. We'll be looking at what the requirements are specifically for each policy and procedure, and how those will be developed. Next slide this is an overview of the offerings in the health home care management track, and please understand that these dates are tentative at this point, so there may be changes. We hope that through this, your health home care managers can develop the knowledge and skills they need to do this new job that they will be a part of. It will be 6 webinars and then 9 in-person sessions, so that the care managers can actually practice some of the new skills that they will need to develop. It begins in June and runs through December. So the first of these, comparing and differentiating the roles of the care manager, the case plan manager, and the county case planner. We'll try to walk you through what the different roles are, how they will work together, and how they can most effectively work together to achieve the outcomes. Topic number two is understanding the MAP enrollment, consent, and confidentiality processes. The first item would be to understand the process for enrollment of a child in a voluntary foster care agency. That process will be somewhat different than the processes for others who are enrolled in children's health homes or adult health homes. Oh, advance the slide, please. Sorry. Okay, sorry for that. So we'll need to actually, this is one slide too far. That's fine. Thank you. To understand how a voluntary foster care child gets enrolled in a health home, with particular emphasis on the complex consent and confidentiality requirements that go along with that, and then how to use this knowledge within your care management agency. How will you use this information to inform the practice of care management in your agency, and also some of the administrative elements of financial modeling. Next slide, please. Supervision. In addition to a general introduction to the role of a supervisor within a health home care management program, we'll be looking to impart information and tools to assist your supervisors in determining things like the appropriate care caseloads for various care management populations. We'll also look to introduce you to some of the newly developing technology tools which can be very helpful in enhancing a care manager's ability to manage the different caseloads that will be in play for a voluntary foster care agency. Next slide, please. Completing assessments and developing care plans is going to be covered in 9 in-person meetings that will take place in various locations across the state. The focus will be on understanding the revised CANS New York assessment, as well as other assessment tools which may be brought in, and how to use that information in development of a care plan, and then looking in depth at the specifics of a care plan for a child and family-centered, resiliency-focused, integrated plan of care, which are the requirements for a health home care plan. Next slide. After that, a group of topics will do a wrap-up at the point of go-live. To review everything we've covered today to assure that you have a solid understanding of what the health home services are and the role of the care manager in making those services available to the voluntary foster care agency population. Next slide. We've scheduled 2 additional post-go-live sessions, thinking that you may have far more questions after go live than you have before go live. So we'll be looking in the first of those post go live sessions to cover implementing care plans, looking at the trigger events that will require a review of the care plan, how to proactively plan for safety, and importantly, to understand the role of the managed care organizations in a health home care management program, what they will require of you, and importantly, what they will do for you and what they can add to the work you're doing. Next slide. The final topic for the care management track is an overview of motivational interviewing and engagement. The learning objectives include understanding the concept of motivational interviewing and various associated tools to assist you in determining when and how to apply motivational interviewing. We'd also look to help you gain knowledge about effective care management techniques for care managers to obtain the necessary buy-in from parents so the care manager can actually provide the health home services. So that's a brief overview of the various topics. As I said, if you notice something that you think is important that is not there, please let us know and we'd be happy to see that that gets included. And with that, I'd like to turn this over to Dan Ferris.
Thanks so much, Adele and John. Again, I'm Dan Ferris, the Assistant Director of Policy and External Affairs.
We'll need to advance the slides.
At the McSilver Institute and part of the Community Technical Assistance Center. We're just so pleased to be a part of this project, and I'll echo Terry and Adele in terms of just what an exciting project team that's been put together to help to offer some of these resources. I've also got really good news for the folks who are listening in, you know, that we're up well past 200 participants, and we're actually ahead of schedule. So I'm going to talk through a few slides, the readiness assessment results, some of the technical assistance and training tools and resources that will be available in the coming months and into 2016, looking a little further ahead. And then we'd also just like to encourage folks as we start to transition towards the tail end of the presentation, if there are questions that folks have, to please feel free to use the chat box to send those in. And we'll begin collecting and sorting through those for what should hopefully be a great discussion in Q&A following the presentation. So many folks are familiar with the Community Technical Assistance Center. I know that others aren't quite so familiar. So just a quick overview. CTAC was founded a few years back in 2011 as the Children's Technical Assistance Center with a focus on OMH kids providers. And it's over the past few years, you know, integrated the adult system and then a very robust Medicaid managed care transition portfolio, which some folks are familiar as the Managed Care Technical Assistance Center, or MCTAC. And all of that falls under an umbrella of the Community Technical Assistance Center of New York. So CTAC and MCTAC, and probably a few other TACs by the time this webinar is wrapped up, are offering foundational information, both around business and clinical efficiencies more broadly for the behavioral health system of New York, and then specifically support and capacity building for managed care readiness as the behavioral health system approaches the implementation of this new system. So just to talk a little bit about the readiness assessment that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. So last summer, the Managed Care Technical Assistance Center worked with the state and plans and providers and representatives from the whole system to pull together, around a dozen or so domains that we identified as the key areas for agencies and providers to be thinking about as we approach the transition. It was originally used as a tool for OMH and OASAS providers specifically, and then as this opportunity arose, we worked with folks who are experts and familiar with the child welfare system to create an OCFS addendum. So, we have great results from that in terms of helping to inform what the current landscape looks like, and then we take those results very, very seriously in terms of informing the technical assistance and tools and resources that will be made available. So the voluntary agencies completed the assessment, and then this was actually a requirement as part of the foster care grant application process, which Alana will be coming back on to talk about in a little bit. And then the application process itself will require the agencies to use results to develop a work plan, both in terms of some of the capacity building they'll be doing around the transition, and then specifically some of the technical assistance and training that they're identifying as being most helpful, both for them and then also to help to inform our processes. So with that, let's jump into the preliminary results. And to do so, let's do that under the lens of what folks will be receiving. So early next week, agencies who submitted a readiness assessment will be receiving a scorecard or report that looks pretty much like this. The numbers, of course, will vary agency to agency. But so what you can see here is an overview at the top of the sample size of the definitions of the terms of what's being presented, and then working through the various domains from the readiness assessment, giving the average score across the sample. So, the 50% mark of where folks are, an agency score, so that would be, how your response is compared to the rest, and leading into the percentile. So again, a couple of things to keep in mind. This is self-perception and self-report, and we had, which we'll be talking about a little bit more later, we had 93 total responses to the survey, and then 89 actually going through because of what they plan to do in terms of providing services. And so with that level of diversity in providers, this is going to be, it's giving a snapshot or a picture of about where folks think they are. But then what you'll also see is, to dig a little deeper and to look back at the responses that you gave and the things that might be pulling your scores in one direction or another. And again, this tool itself will be coupled with a series of recommendations for the subject areas. So if you score, you know, if your score in communications or demonstrating impact or contracting are particularly low, what are the specific things and suggested activities that you might want to consider building into a work plan for technical assistance and capacity building to help prepare for the transition? And one last thing, just taking another look at this, because we look at this all the time, but we know other folks might not be so familiar. The scoring on this is done on a scale of 1 to 5, where 1 is really, you know, not at all ready and not at all prepared or comfortable from, again, from a self-perception standpoint. And 5 is, you know, we don't need any assistance or help. We've got this covered. So again, we were able, so all 93 OCFS voluntary agencies participated in this part of the initiative. And so 89 filled out the actual readiness assessment, and then 4 responded to one of the first 2 questions on whether or not to provide behavioral health services or health home care management. And then if folks answered no to that, they, you know, there wasn't really a need for them to fill out the whole questionnaire. So that's the difference between the 93 and the 89. And then 5 agencies didn't submit responses in time to be included in the overall analysis. So again, when we're looking at the percentiles and the aggregate scores or the average scores, it doesn't include everyone who submitted a readiness assessment. It takes a little bit of time to run the numbers and to dive in on them. But those agencies did submit them in time to receive a score benchmarking them against the sample regardless. So without further ado, so the first question, as we mentioned, does your agency currently or plan to provide mental health, substance abuse, or primary care services? 83 or 89% answered yes. And 10 agencies or 11% answered no. And then on health home care coordination, again, we had the majority of folks answering yes, they plan to provide health home care coordination, 65%. A few folks saying no, and about 20% or 1 in 5 of respondents were still undecided. So that's just something to keep in mind as we're looking through what the technical assistance and training that will be offered is. For the agencies that currently provide on-site primary health services, 61% currently provide and 39% don't. So it's about a 60-40 split. Of the 61%, or you know, the 50 agencies that currently provide, 43 of those plan to continue providing them moving forward in the new healthcare landscape. And then 5 of the agencies that currently provide services plan to pursue Article 28 licensure. And as I'm talking through the agency characteristics, one thing that I would just want to mention is that this is really just getting a sense of who the OCFS voluntary agencies are, what services they're currently providing, and then to help inform this project and just the states and technical assistance partners who are our co-presenters today, what our thinking is around what's going to be made available, and just to help inform the overall process by having a better idea of what services folks plan to provide. So jumping back in, so the agencies that currently provide behavioral health services, so that's a large percentage of the OCFS voluntary agencies. And so of the 76 agencies that currently provide behavioral health services, 99% plan to continue providing them, which is fantastic. And now we're just going to take a quick look at the percent of current reimbursement from Medicaid. So this slide is showing that 32%, around a third of agencies who completed the readiness assessment, reported back that more than 75% of their current reimbursement comes from Medicaid. And then looking through the chart, 18% is less than 10%, 14% in the 10 to 25% range, 8% in the 26 to 50% range, and one thing I'd just like to throw in about this is that the percent of percent of current reimbursement from Medicaid is, we think that this reflects the services more than the client populations. And the vast majority of clients that are being served by OCFS voluntary agencies are covered by Medicaid or Medicaid eligible, but funding for the services has been traditionally via per diems and through the state. So we think that's a reflection of that. And looking at slide 48 and the percent of current reimbursement from commercial insurance just helps to reaffirm and back up our thinking on that. So there's a very high percentage of voluntary agencies who are receiving under 10% of their current reimbursement from commercial insurance. And again, just quickly, one of the areas that we've identified as being really critical to day one preparedness and then ongoing management of a managed care system for an agency is electronic billing software and then electronic health records. So this gave us a really good sense in terms of the capacity of agencies, and this is also a great way to kind of think about where your own agency is compared to the rest of the system around use of electronic billing software. So just to quickly run through the bar chart, 35% of respondents have electronic billing software at all of their sites, and that also just reminds me to mention that this is the readiness assessment is done at an agency-wide level and not a program level. So then the next bar is really telling that an equal amount that have it at all sites use electronic billing for some but not all of their sites and programs. And then a smaller percentage don't currently have it but are in the progress towards implementation. And then about 1 in 5 respondents were saying that their programs do not use electronic billing at all at this point. And then again, for electronic health records, actually it's quite a few fewer agencies responded in the affirmative that they have EHR at all of their sites. A few more have it at some, but not all. And then the majority of respondents, about 60%, either don't have it and are currently in progress towards EHR implementation or just do not use EHR at this point. So just quickly to talk through the readiness assessment areas, and I know that many of the folks on the phone, either personally or someone on their team completed the readiness assessment. So we won't spend too much time going through what the different questions are in the area, but when we come back around to Q&A, if folks need a little more guidance or clarification on that, we're happy to provide it. But the 11 domains of the key areas that we're looking at through the assessment are understanding MCOs, managed care organizations, contracting, communications, IT system requirements, level of care, utilization management, member services and grievance procedures, interface with physical health, social support and health homes or integrated care, quality management, finance and billing, access requirements, and then number 11 is outcomes. So here's a look across the population, again, on a scale of 1 to 5 of where the OCFS voluntary agencies who responded to the readiness assessment land in terms of their mean scores. So looking through communication and evaluation are lower than the rest of the scores. That wasn't surprising on our end, to be honest, and it was the same for OMH and OASAF agencies. Those were the two lowest domains. Those are the two areas where they're really geared more towards what the new landscape looks like. So folks, aren't expected to be quite as far along in those as some of the other areas. And just looking through, interface was extraordinarily high for OCFS agencies. IT, MCO priorities and contracting, finance also pretty solid and like in the mid range where some folks have lots of experience, other folks might not be quite so far along, and then another batch kind of falls squarely in the middle. And the technical assistance that we're going to be offering, which we'll be coming to a little later in the presentation, is really geared and tailored to try to address, as best as it can, those different groups of readiness. So whether you're further along or not quite so far along, experienced with Medicaid or maybe even managed care for, you know, some of the different portfolios of work that your agency might cover, there will be something to gain from the different technical assistance and training opportunities that are coming down the road. And again, I mentioned for communication and evaluation that it was also the lowest for OMH and OACS, as well as for OCFS. So just really quickly, I think it's helpful to kind of just talk for a minute before we flip through the comparison charts about the OMH and OACS readiness results. And also at the urging of our eval and stats wonks here at the office, just mentioned that the OMH and OACS sample was 313 agencies. And the OCFS sample, as we mentioned, that we actually ran in terms of the numbers, for most of the questions, we had about 84 or so responses one way or another. So just something to keep in mind in terms of the sample size and possibly how that could pull the numbers one way or another. And so with OMH and OACS, we found that there weren't statistically significant differences by region. That was something that going in, we were looking at really closely in terms of, you know, upstate or outside New York City, rest of state, whatever terminology you like to use. And then the city folks came out pretty evenly in terms of their self-perception of their readiness. And then there are statistically significant differences by reimbursement. So folks with more experience with Medicaid, you know, are further along in terms of where they think they're ready to operate in a managed care environment. And then also there's statistically significant differences by agency type. And so agency type refers to, we kind of used as a replacement for size. We didn't ask folks how big they are, how many people they serve or anything like that in the readiness assessment. So it's not an exact science, but agencies that have licensure from more than one state agency, you know, so that their OMH and OACS are tended to be more prepared than folks who are just one or the other. So getting back to the slides and what you have in front of you. So just looking through, this is just showing that the OMH and OACS agencies as a whole tend to be a little bit further along, but again, just really couching that with the size of the sample. And the number of responses that got it probably tended to pull the numbers a little bit higher up. And again, just looking through with level of care, member services, interface was also really high for OMH and OACS like it was for OCFS, quality. And then finance access. And like I mentioned before, evaluation and communication, which was number three, were the lowest scores for OMH and OACS, so the OCFS agencies that responded share that in common with them. And so quickly moving on to training tools and resources. So when we're thinking about the technical assistance that will be offered, we've had some conversations on our end, and I know providers have been sending us feedback in real time, which is always greatly appreciated, that there's a lot going on. And agencies are being pulled in a lot of different directions from a leadership standpoint, from a management standpoint, from an administrative standpoint, and then just from a day-to-day caseload, workload standpoint. So our goal here is to be as clear as possible with what the different trainings and technical assistance opportunities are, who they're for, so we're making sure we're getting the right people in the room, and then also just helping the agencies who are participating in this initiative think through what are the best fits for them. So the first question off the top that folks can be asking themselves goes right back to the readiness assessment. So off the top, how do I know what I need? And so this is to consider at an agency level whether you're going to provide primary health care, behavioral health, and or substance abuse services in the new environment, whether or not your agency is going to become a downstream health home care coordinator, and if you're still not sure. And if you're still not sure in figuring out, we tend to operate and to take advantage of the trainings as if you were planning to do those activities. And then loop back around if needed afterwards when you have a better sense of, you know, the direction that strategically that your agency is headed. And building off of that, then there's a second layer of questions that you can be asking. Do we currently have an Article 31 or Article 28 license? If not, is that something that we're considering in terms of our long-term strategic plan? Do we currently have contracts with managed care, not around behavioral health, but in other areas? Is Medicaid billing a significant portion of our business? You know, we talked in the readiness assessment results about how many of the providers have direct billing with Medicaid, and then how many are operating on a per diem or a reimbursement with a state basis. Do we use revenue cycle management? We'll be talking about that a little bit later. And then also, what is our experience and comfort level with outcomes, utilization management, and credentialing? As we mentioned from the readiness assessment, outcomes was one of the lower scoring areas of the domain, but it's also not necessarily something that we emphasize as like absolutely critical for day one. It's something for a long-term approach that's going to be really, really, really important. If three reallys weren't enough, we could throw a fourth one in there. But something that we really emphasize, see, there's number four, in terms of agencies thinking about not just what they need for, again, day one readiness when the change happens to Medicaid managed care, but thinking about who are the people that they serve and what they, how they treat them and how they serve them as a population and individuals. So a quick look, overview of the technical assistance schedule on our end. I know Adele and John did a fantastic job laying out what they'll be offering for health home coordination. And so we'll be sending out an announcement in the next few days, probably early to mid next week, with our registration information for a webinar on Wednesday, June 3rd from 1:30 to 3 p.m., talking about how agencies can use those individualized benchmarking reports to create a work plan. A few slides down the road, we have like a sample draft template of what that work plan might look like, so folks can start thinking about that. And then completing the foster care grant application, which again, Lana's gonna come back on shortly to talk people through what that process is going to look like. And then we'll also be doing a CTAC office hours around the work plan creation. So folks should not feel like they're on their own with this. We have a great response time in terms of email questions, but we also understand that sometimes email back and forth is not the best or only way to provide assistance on some of the questions that are coming up. So around work plan development and readiness assessment, as people are looking through their answers, we'll get on the line for an hour. Folks can send questions in advance or just bring them on. And we'll sit and talk folks through anything that's coming up around their work plans or as they're thinking through their readiness assessment results. And then looking at the summer, again, the timeline implementation change has shifted our thinking around what to offer and when. And with health homes going live in the fall, it's kind of allowed us to not overwhelm folks with too much TA and training all at once and spread it out over the next year or so. But we also don't want to just completely hold off on any foundations of managed care for the OCFS voluntary agencies in the meantime. I think it's a good balance to take advantage of the extended timeline and the additional time that folks are going to have to prepare and to think through a lot of the new parts of the system. But at the same time, to spread it out and not put too much of a training TA burden on folks, because I know we appreciate how busy everyone is and how pulled in so many directions people are. But over the summer, we're planning to offer a managed care 101 for OCFS voluntary agencies. This is covering foundational elements, so MCO priorities, terminology, and then the keys to operating in a managed care environment across the board. So not domain specific as much, it's just really introducing like what this really looks like on a very functional basis. Getting a little less tied up in some of the policy decisions, although we can talk through those and answer any questions that folks have along the way. But then also specifically working with folks to develop, or if they're already in the process of doing it, refining their strategy and business plan for managed care. And so that will be looking back with folks at their readiness assessment results and then implementing a couple of short new tools as well to help folks think through where they are and where they need to be going. And then around the specific domains, you know, we've highlighted, you know, for day one, and then also broken things out as, you know, things that are critically important, but, you know, don't come first. So we try to think about the technical assistance from a chronological standpoint, and kind of work it through. And with the technical assistance that is going to be offered and has been offered just for folks who might not be as familiar with CTAC and MCTAC, everything we do, this webinar included, is recorded, Q&A is captured and circulated as like a hard physical copy later after we've double-checked to make sure all of the answers are clear and as accurate as possible. And then the slides are sent around, and that's for both the webinars and in-person events. So just something to mention. We always encourage people to attend live. But we also know from experience that sometimes it takes a few times, you know, sitting through the material, working through it to really come around and to grasp what's being presented. New questions are always coming up, and so we always encourage folks to refer back to the FAQ or slide decks that have been distributed. But then also that there we'll have office hours and there's the email address also that we'll share at the end with our contact information and web address where folks can always shoot questions as they come up our way. But so with that in mind, the readiness domain specific training will likely start in early 2016 as we're planning now. And then again about the work plan development. Again, Lana will be talking a little bit more about the contracting process. But so just to briefly introduce that, so using a work plan template and the results of the readiness assessment, and then a corresponding menu or list of just suggested activities in folks' areas of greatest need, voluntary agencies will be developing their own strategies as part of the contracting process with DOH for some capacity building funds. And then we'll be guiding as a group, as a technical assistance group, through what options and activities are intended for day one readiness, as we've mentioned, and then what's geared more towards ongoing long-term transition TA needs. And again, it might not be the easiest thing for folks to see in a small condensed slide version, but this is a draft template of what that work plan may look like. So it'll go through the objectives, you know, where folks will identify the areas in which they're looking to build capacity, both based on their own needs and their own interests, but then also informed by the readiness assessment results that you'll be getting next week. Identifying specific tasks, and again, we're refining a list of suggested activities and answers for, you know, steps that folks can take, you know, based on how they responded to certain questions in the different domains. The resources that are needed, performance measures, funding sources, and then, you know, just to, making sure that this is also a helpful ongoing tool for folks in a working document that agencies can use, an estimated date of completion. And then we'll be talking a little bit more on some of the tools and resources later in the presentation, but one thing I just wanted to mention off the top around Managed Care 101 is in addition to over the summer having a Managed Care 101 activity training session that we'll be offering across the state, we'll be releasing in the coming weeks Managed Care 101 template presentations. We know that agency leadership and the folks who are on this call aren't the only people who need to be brought up to speed on what's going on in terms of the transition. And so we have three iterations of a similar presentation that has information presented in a certain way, and then also discussion questions that are tailored for different audiences. So off the top, that's for agency leadership, and then also a version for frontline staff, and then for board members. So those are the folks that we consider to be the three, you know, generic levels of staff, with of course folks scattered in between those who the agency leadership and management might want to be informing and bringing up to speed about the transition that's happening. And so the slides will work in a way where folks will be able to download a slide deck and talk through it themselves if that's what they're interested in. We'll also be doing a recording or, you know, a narration of the slides if it's, you know, just easier from a technological standpoint or a time standpoint to send it around as a starting point for a conversation for a Medicaid managed care readiness team that you might be working with internally, just to make sure that everyone who's participating is on the same page and has the same information. So again, the domain-specific offerings that will be coming down the pipe in, we would say, you know, early 2016, they'll be tailored specifically for foster care agencies. Terry, when she was mentioning some of the project partners, mentioned that we're working very closely with Ray Shimmer, who is just a fantastic wealth of information and knowledge about how we can make the information around managed care as applicable as possible to the OCFS voluntary agencies. And then we also always integrate the feedback and questions we get in real time from folks into informing what we'll be talking and covering. So we always encourage, as we get further and further along in the process, to please, you know, spend, I'll echo Adele on this, to please let us know if there are things that we're missing or pieces or specific areas within the broader domains that would be really helpful. For example, on the MCTAC side, we did a whole contracting unit for OMH and OASAS providers back last fall. This is a, you know, the adult implementation timeline was looming, and contracting is often the first thing to cover. And within that, we've heard back that value proposition for that, for example, is like one of the areas that folks could really use some more help with. So now we're working in the background to roll something out around that later this year. So again, we take the feedback that we get from the individual events, and if you've been to a CTAC or MCTAC event, you've probably filled out one of those feedback forms. We take them very seriously. We have weekly meetings to go through the feedback that we're receiving in terms of the emails and events that we're having. So we really do encourage people to send that in. In addition to the tailoring of materials, we're going to be integrating and coordinating with the health home TA whenever possible. Again, with this new timeline, the health home piece is really moving forward first, but we'll make sure that, you know, if there's overlap in the timing between the foundations of managed care, the work plan development, any follow-up on the readiness assessment or a deeper dive into some of those numbers, that what that's really looking like is it's coordinated and they won't be conflicting, so folks won't have to be in two places at once, as much as I'm sure we all would love to have that ability. We'll also be working off of a master schedule. So the trainings, at the very least, with an estimated month of happening, will be, you know, when we're further down the road, if not a specific day, will be laid out for folks as they're working on their work plan, so folks will be able to plan accordingly. And then again, we do both an in-person and web-based combination to address the separate domain areas. So again, just the main areas that we'll be covering, in addition to the foundations, is contracting, business improvement practices and strategy, revenue cycle management, utilization management, and then outcomes and data-driven decision-making. So just quickly running through what those are and the target audiences for them. So with contracting, we're looking primarily at the things that are really helpful for day one functionality as folks will have contracts signed or need to have contracts signed with managed care before offering any services or being able to bill. So what we're looking at is negotiation, leverage, demonstrating value, provider networks, and the target audience for that is really agency leadership and obviously anyone on the contracting team at a respective agency. And for revenue cycle management and business practices, so I think what that really is looking like is the administrative and clinical functions that are contributing to the management of client service revenue. Revenue cycle management specific is describing the life cycle of a client account from its creation to payment collection and resolution. So from, you know, pre-registration all the way to, you know, an appeal, a possible appeal, or tracking that person's outcomes over time. And so, again, that's prior to service, during services, following services, and ongoing. And that includes, you know, process improvement. But that's really, the revenue cycle management piece is really geared towards finance staff and frontline staff. Of course, agency leadership, who's, you know, looking to learn more about that, is always welcome to join, and we encourage that as well. Utilization management is geared towards agency leadership, quality assurance management, and then also the quality improvement team, as we're looking at this as well. And that's determining what's medically necessary, appropriate, and effective, and how to navigate that area in a managed care environment. Outcomes and data-driven decision-making is, you know, a little self-explanatory, but it's that unit's geared towards agency leadership again, thinking through the populations that are served and taking data and numbers to inform not just the work that you're doing, but how you talk about yourself and you're able to market yourself in terms of the new landscape. And so there's some overlap there along with the contracting unit as well. And then last but not least is business improvement practices and strategies. So the foundations of managed care that we talked about is really geared towards that. And any system transition that's as large as what we're discussing today, we'll always want to cover and provide resources around strategic organizational change, and then change management and leadership. So one of the things that we always like to emphasize is that there's a difference between, you know, with strategic change, what's often seen by agency leadership as, you know, a strategic change is often then interpreted by frontline staff and others who might not be so closely, you know, working on the transition activities as shock change. And so we always look to provide with these initiatives some resources to help agency leadership to, you know, kind of navigate those waters and figure out communication. I think the template presentations that'll be coming out in the next few weeks are going to be one of those opportunities. And then for what participants can do to make the most of these technical assistance supports. So the first thing, and hopefully folks did this already, or did a version of this around the readiness assessment, is to designate a Medicaid managed care readiness project team. And so that can include all of the staff or representatives of the staff from the target audiences from the trainings that we were just talking through. But then really geared towards, you know, the decision makers at the agency who are going to be informing and guiding the transition process at the agency level. So we also, in addition to that, just recommend more generally speaking, for agencies, despite as busy as we all are, to take the opportunities on the front end and commit to taking the time and effort needed to assess, diagnose, improve, and monitor organizational operations, business practices, and financial performance. And thinking about it even now, well ahead, actually, of the transition for the folks who are on this call, thinking about it in terms of the new landscape or the new system with Medicaid managed care and how you currently fit in with that. And then starting to identify some of the things that will be needed well ahead of time. And then last but not least, just to really utilize the trainings, tools, and resources that are made available. And as we were reiterating earlier, just to please provide constant feedback to us in terms of what's being offered, and then other tools that could be useful. And you'll see when we're talking quickly about the tools, just, you know, how critical the feedback is in terms of what we've been creating and offering. So what's available now in terms of tools and resources through some of the other managed care work we've been doing? So recordings and slides for all of the in-person and online trainings that have happened around managed care are available. So for folks just looking for more broad overviews, those presentations are tailored for mental health substance use providers. And again, we'll be, you know, tailoring and refining the presentations for early next year when we roll them out specifically for OCFS. Another just side comment is what we really look forward to with those is with the OCFS agency population is a little bit smaller, you know, it's under 100 agencies, whereas OMH and OASAS together are 800 or 900. So the format of the events that we can have with OCFS leadership and staff is a little bit different. So we're very conscious of that, and we're excited to have a little bit more of an interactive event or training TA setup than what we've been able to have when you have 400 people in a room, for example. We also, coming from feedback at one of our events, we created a managed care glossary, top acronyms cheat sheet. It's actually a printable 5x7 card of some of the most frequently confused or frequently arising acronyms that folks can have. It's a 5x7 card that people can print out and literally just tape up on their wall. And then we always like if people send us pictures of it taped up on our wall. It, you know, helps the staff who are updating these things on a regular basis keep enthused about it to know that it's being utilized. And then also the key terms for managed care. And again, that came from someone in the back of the room at an event just saying, there's so many acronyms and like there's so many terms in all the different areas of healthcare in New York State and even beyond, that it would just be so helpful to have a tool that would help to read through that. We have FAQs, both from the kickoff of this initiative. We'll have an FAQ posted of this. And then we also released a couple of months back around an output to outcomes project, an online assessment measure database, which folks can take a look at, and that we'll be integrating into some of the outcomes work that we're doing. And then coming soon is a managed care plan matrix. This will be incredibly helpful as we'll capture, when we create these tools, the goal is always to identify opportunities where agencies will individually have to do a lot of work to pull information together. And so if we as a TA Technical Assistance Training Center can do a little bit of the heavy lifting and across the board and then save individual providers time, that's one of the areas where we think we can bring some really great value to folks. So the matrix follows that model where we're creating an interactive map of New York State where ultimately you'll be able to click on a region, see all of the plans that are active in that region, and then pull up critical information from contact information to contracting to credentialing. And so we'll be rolling this out in phases starting in June. And then also a managed care script or lists of things that you can prepare and have ready for when you start talking to a managed care organization. And then again, as we mentioned, the managed care 101 presentations. So again, the glossary that was a great suggestion from the back of a room in a training, just a visual of what that is. And that currently lives at mictac.org under Get the Right Tools. And specifically to this project, we have a project-specific website set up at ctacny.com, OCFS-technical-assistance, and then a project-specific email for general inquiries, for questions, logistics, where's the world going, whatever, ocfsta.info@nyu.edu. We typically, if it's a logistical question, you know, someone's having registration problems or just, you know, wanted to make sure they didn't miss something, can get back to people in 24 to 48 hours. Some of the questions we get, as I'm sure you can imagine, and looking through the chat box at the things that are coming through, they're a little more longer and complicated, and so it just takes us a little bit more time. But usually there's no more than a week turnaround for even some of the more complicated policy questions that we receive. And then also just for people's reference, the official announcement that the Department of Health issued back in February is also on that website. So folks, you know, are feeling like they just want to get another grounding of, you know, the framework of what's going on after they sign off of the webinar today, that's a great place to start. And then from the kickoff that we held, the webinar slides and video recording is available from that, and the FAQ for that is that we were looking through that the other day in preparation for today, and it's really a robust list of a whole variety of questions around the transition, specifically for OCFS voluntary agency. And then coming soon to that website, in true CTAC fashion, will be a recording and slides for this presentation, and then the tools and resources and trainings that we'll be offering down the line as well. So with that, I'd like to turn things back over to Lana, and thanks everyone for your time and looking forward to working with everyone.
Hi, everyone. Thank you very much, Dan. That was great. So lots of information. So we're coming, winding down and making some very good time, and we'll get to questions shortly. So just want to talk about the grants and the application process, and we can go ahead and advance to the next slide. So as folks know, there's been $20 million in resources. About $18 million of those will be distributed through the request for application grant process. The formula to do so by statute will be developed between OCFS and DOH, and we're working on doing that. I think the key there is that we will let you know the amount that you're going to receive shortly so that you have a sense on what that is. And you can begin to think about that in terms of the completion of the readiness assessments that you've all done. So the ability to apply for the grant is contingent upon your completion of that readiness assessment. And then as part of the grant process, you'll complete a work plan demonstrating how you would want to use your grant to address the needs identified in the benchmark reporting that Dan was just talking about. So that's kind of the setup. If we want to advance to the next slide, I think we were also trying to give you folks some heads up on some of the things that will be required as part of the application documentation process. You know, I think I've talked to many of you separately and independently about how this money can go out, and we tried as hard as we could to make it more of a grant process, but we are faced with an application process and a contract process. So we are committed to working as diligently as we can within that somewhat cumbersome and administrative process to work effectively to both help in the application process, identify the needs along with all of the great materials that CTAC will provide to you to do that, and then work your way through the application process and then work your way through the contract process with us. So we stand on the ready to make it as least painful as possible. And on this slide, there's a few things that are required that we'll be providing additional information as we go along the process. You can see they're listed: statewide financial system vendor ID, registration in the grants gateway. There's a vendor responsibility questionnaire, and some of you may be familiar with some of the stuff if you've engaged in the contract process with New York, but this follows the documentation required in the RFA type process, the request for application. The work plan will be part of the application, and in trying to streamline that work, we on purpose are making the work plan that you'll prepare part of that application, so they're sort of streamlining the work and not creating separate documentation. It becomes part of the application process. And we really would like to encourage, and you know, CTAC will be available to kind of help us think through some of these issues with you, but to the extent that, you know, the pooling of resources among voluntary foster care agencies can be a really effective way to purchase items that you all can jointly use. And so we are strongly encouraging that, and we'll be teeing that notion up in the application process as well. And then the next slide just tries to give you some tentative deadlines around the application process. And again, we're committed to working as quickly as we can. Ideally, you know, we do have a little more time in the schedule for readiness activities, but we understand that the more lead time you have, the better. So we're not looking to slow the process down of getting you the dollars, even though we have a little more time, because we'd like to make sure that that extra time is really on your side for implementation. So you can see that we've teed up the projected dates around the application, and the reason why they're projected is because we don't completely have 100% control over the application approval process. And while we will work here as diligently as possible to move that through and have the applications distributed in early June, we may meet with administrative timeframes along the way that have us detract a little bit from that schedule. But it is our goal to stay on track. So on the 18th, you can be looking for your benchmark reports. We'll have a post-webinar with an FAQ available so that there's some digestion going on there and an opportunity to ask questions. We are teeing up again to notify you of what the award allocation is that you can expect and that you would be applying for through the application process at the end of the month. And then we would have another webinar on the application process and work plan development to provide you assistance in that regard, and then distribute the application. and then there would be time for you to complete the application, of course, and that we're looking forward to be submitted September 1st. We have given ourselves a relatively short time frame to review those applications. So we have just given ourselves 30 days. There'll be a lot of heads down with many applications to review. It's an aggressive time frame, but we will work as quickly as we can to do that. And then we think there's the work that needs to be done to execute the contracts. So it's our goal to have all of that work done by the end of the year, and to try to stick as closely as we can to this schedule. And I think our next slide brings us to our question segment. And I'm going to turn that back over to folks to provide direction on how. I think we asked folks throughout the webinar to go ahead and use the chat box to submit questions, so we can go ahead and go to the questions.
Yeah, that sounds great. And so we've been collecting the questions as they've been coming in. And folks should please feel free to continue as things are coming to mind to keep sending them our way, and we'll get to as many as we can. And like we mentioned, we're ahead of schedule, so should be plenty of time to get to what people are asking. So if it works best as we're getting started, I'll just pose a question that we've gotten, and then the state folks are. Our partners at IPRO or NYCCP, or who knows, maybe even us when it's technical assistance related, we'll chime in. So just off the top, and I think it was one of the first questions to come in, and one of the best things just to make abundantly clear is the transition going to affect voluntary agencies currently delivering services, and what does this mean for cost reimbursement set by the state?
I'm sorry, Dan, we're
trying to get the questions.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Can I trouble you just to read the question again?
Yeah. No problem at all. And for the panelists, those are as they stream in, they'll be showing up in boxes shortly, just so you guys have a list to look through as well. But so the question was, is the transition going to affect voluntary agencies who currently deliver services? And then what does that mean for cost reimbursement as it's set by the state?
I'm not sure I completely understand the question. So in terms of the way that the voluntary foster care agencies are reimbursed by the state under the managed care environment when foster care kids are enrolled in managed care, do we think that's the question?
Yes.
Okay. So there will be differences, and I think in our last webinar, Dan, we teed up, you know, and part of this gets back to the readiness activities of what will your role be when you when we're in that environment. Will you be a provider that continues to provide services? And if so, you would be engaged with plans to provide services and become a contracted provider with the plans, is the other way. And, of course, we've talked about the important costs that are incurred by the voluntary foster care agencies today through the residual per diem and working closely with folks, through the foster care per diem, and teeing up the notion of developing a residual per diem that would allow critical costs for the voluntary foster care agencies to function and provide their roles. And continue to have those costs flow in the residual per diem environment. And so that will be under development in parallel with the development of the per member per month per capita premiums that would be established in managed care environments when the foster care population shifts to managed care. And if others on the folks want to add to that, if other folks on the phone want to add to that response, please do so.
Yeah, I think that really got at what the person was asking. So thank you, Lana.
Sure.
And the questions around that will continue to come through from different perspectives also. So I think we'll probably reiterate a version of the answer a couple of times before we wrap up today. A question around health homes. So if a voluntary agency is associated with more than one health home, how is it decided to which health home the child will be enrolled in?
So the folks should take a look at the assignment and referral webinar that's been posted to the website. There's a nice use case scenario that is related to foster care. But to answer the question, so if a voluntary foster care agency has been chosen by the LDSS to provide health home care management and they're linked to more than one health home, one of the things that we'll look to is whether or not there is a loyalty match, if you will, to where the child is currently receiving services so that there's an alignment between the network of the health home provider and the voluntary foster care agency. And also down the road, when the child is enrolled in a plan, when the foster care children migrate to plan, the other alignment that we'll look for is whether or not the plan has a relationship to the health home. So if there's more than one, the loyalty match can be considered, and then the voluntary foster care agency can pick the health home.
Great. So moving on, with the expanded services being implemented before managed care, will voluntary agencies be expected to pay for these services out of the continued per diem, or will we be able to bill Medicaid outside of the per diem?
I think the funding structure and the rates around the state plan services is under development, and so that discussion will unfold as we continue to work on the state plan amendment. Laura, I don't know if you have anything to add to that. She had to leave. Okay.
So again, and this is getting back to some health home nuance. Will the state be able to tell agencies the difference between care managers as opposed to case planners, along with the qualifications to be care managers or case planners?
Yeah, so as part of the training, and we've been working closely with OCFS to lend some clarity around the roles of the case planner and the health home care manager. And so over the next couple of weeks, we'll be working to provide information and more clarity around those roles and how that will look in the health home environment. And then that information will be teed up in the training sessions that folks will participate in, both at the state level and through the voluntary foster care agencies training that we've talked about here today for health home.
Great. And then quickly, I'll just jump in with two hopefully low-hanging fruit questions about the Technical Assistance Center. So one was, where do we find the resources that were covered during the earlier presentation. And so again, folks can go to ctacny.com, and then along the top of that is a tab or a link specifically to OCFS TA, and then also more generally and broadly around managed care transition, the mctac.org is also a great place to go to see copies of the RFQ that the state put out for MCOs, the kickoff series, which really overlaid, you know, like where the system is heading, and a variety of the tools and resources that we went through. Also other upcoming events that are, you know, maybe not directly tailored or directed for foster care agencies, but that folks might be interested in. And then Lana also covered this in her final part about the contracting process, is when can folks expect benchmarking reports? And so just to reiterate that those should be going out, that folks should be receiving those in their inboxes early next week. The goal is to start sending those out on Monday. So another question, more on the system change. If contracts are executed on December 31st, 2015, in terms of the contracting with the state for capacity funds, when can foster agencies expect to receive funds or get paid, you know, receive the first installment of funding?
So I don't have a good answer for that. The vouchering process runs through a cycle. I can try to get more information about how long it takes to turn around a voucher that's submitted through SFS. I just don't have that answer with me today. I apologize. I'll see if I can get more clarity around potential timeframes.
Yeah, totally fine. And that's, and again, a great chance just to remind folks that we'll be posting a more formal FAQ with all of the questions and answers from today and sending that around to everyone. Our goal is to get it by late next week, so stay tuned for that. A question that came in is about how this process impacts the CSE population.
Probably one for Laura.
Okay.
Mimi, are you on?
I am on. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear.
Yeah. We certainly understand the complications associated with the CSE population that's placed with our voluntary foster care agencies in a residential setting, and those are conversations that we're actively engaged in with the health department in terms of how to figure out how to deal with the population of kids who are Medicaid eligible and who are not Medicaid eligible. So, we're working through the policy implications of that relatively small yet very important population.
Great, that's helpful, Mimi, thank you. And how do we as an agency become trained and certified, certified in quotations, to be able to administer CANS assessment?
So, there's four training sessions scheduled, and they are, I think if you look at the April 29th webinar, you'll see them. But essentially, there's a Learner Nation online module that you will gain access to, complete the training, and that gives you the certification that you need to then enter the Medicaid Analytics Performance Portal to then complete a CAN. And so that information about how to do all that and become trained will be available later this summer according to that schedule that we put out. So there's a time frame when you'll be able to begin to access the online training. And I apologize, I don't have it in front of me, so I forget what that date is. And then there's four in-person sessions that will happen across the state, I believe in the months of August in September, and I think you can begin to access the training, I think we said mid-June. But those dates are in the April 29th webinar, and then we, as time goes by and we get closer to those dates, we'll provide folks additional information on how to in terms of access.
The next question is about technology needs. This is something we talked about a little bit in the presentation, but didn't dive too deeply into. Has there been any thought to forming some method to partner the Department of Health, OCFS, COFCA, and agencies to collaboratively look at technology needs, challenges, and system data flows? And the person who asked the question compared it to what OPWDD did with the stakeholder information technology work group for the People First waiver. So if you know, either Mimi or Lana can just talk a little bit about, you know, the capacity grants and or the capacity funding and what that could mean for technology needs.
Yeah, so in terms of, you know, encouraging collaboration, I think both Mimi and I would be willing to engage in discussions about how to do that. We certainly, as I indicated at the end of the presentation, will be looking for folks to form partnerships in a way that can most easily maximize the efficient use of the dollars that each of you get if you pool them together into terms of using them for your readiness activities. And with respect to things like connections, you know, down the road, we hope that there'll be connections with, through the map, but it's just not, we don't have the ability to have that really be a day one or even an intermediate term goal, given all the complexities around it. But it is certainly part of a long-term conversation about how to connect, if you will, those varying child welfare systems. I think that is a big challenge, one that we're certainly ready to face, but I think we've got initial implementation things with respect to standing up MAP, getting the health home program running through MAP before we get to some of those larger considerations. But they certainly should be a backdrop as we all collectively think about what's the best use and how do we get ready for the transitions that are going to occur. But I think we would be willing to discuss if folks have creative ways to think about ways to pool resources in a way that is effective. And I think once folks see the benchmark report, you know, hopefully that will provide additional information to help the voluntary foster care agencies leverage those kinds of discussions amongst one another.
Great. Another question that came through about licensure. Is an Article 31 license necessary for OCFS VA agency for OCFS voluntary agencies, or is it that their internal therapists and psychiatrists are able to credential directly on the managed care panel?
I don't off the top of my head know the answer to that question, so we can go ahead and...
Great. We'll add it to the list. And then looking down, and again, thank you so much to everyone who's on the line. We're still over 200 participants, which is fantastic for when we break into Q&A. So there's obviously some robust discussion and questions that folks have. So we're just getting through them as best as we can and trying to organize them in a way that makes sense. So again, thanks for folks' patience as we're working through this. So looking down through the questions, so one question was, how do you suggest that agencies best prepare for October 1st enrollment in health homes when the capacity funding for managed care isn't released until January 2016?
So the capacity funding for managed care really is focused on managed care transition activities. The health home program comes with a per member per month fee for providing care management services. So that is the resource that is available to agencies to provide health home care management.
Great. And then if you are a downstream provider on the health home conversation, if you're a downstream provider, who will you bill for residual costs for Medicaid or the managed care program?
So I think the question is, how will the residual per diem flow to the downstream care manager?
That's a much better way of putting it.
Yeah, except that he said downstream care manager to the voluntary foster care agency, right? So as we develop the residual per diem, we'll have to think about the flow. I think the current concept has been that it would flow through the plan, but I think we're open to how that ends up working based upon the construct of the per diem itself. So I know at the CROSCA meeting, we presented some kind of overall concepts around how a residual per diem might be built. And so I think as those flush themselves out, we'll begin to think about the flow. It generally makes sense to have things flow through one party, and typically that could be the plan. But depending upon the components of the residual per diem and how they flow, there might be other mechanisms to have those resources be directed to the foster care agencies. So I think we're open. I think that conversation will come through the more detailed development of the residual per diem.
Great. A question about preventive services. In addition to foster care services or activities. So how does prevention fit into the changing healthcare system?
So I can answer that question with respect to, Mimi can chime in here too. I think one of the folks have asked us with preventive services to try to preserve the linkage in health home assignments. So the referral and assignment algorithms that we've developed try to do that to the extent that we can, given the limited data availability. You know, there's no central warehouse that we can quickly look to say, you know, is a kid in preventive services, and then link that back up through MAP. So we, as creatively as possible, incorporated that into the assignment process to preserve those relationships where possible. I don't know, Mimi, if you have anything you want to add to that.
That was really helpful. The only thing I would add is that at this point, there's no expectation that the contracts that local departments of social services have with any agency for preventive services will be altered as we move into the transition.
Great.
One question we received. So for agencies that are primed and ready to go and start working, they're asking about the application due date. And is there a way that agencies who are ready or eager to get started, you know, tomorrow, is there a way for them to apply and have funds be made available earlier than the current timeline?
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. I spent much of the summer trying to figure out a way to do just that, and the process that we have is the process we have to follow, which is the application process and then the contract process following the approval of applications. So, again, I think the timeline that we prepared and showed you earlier in the slides is as aggressive as I think we could do within the process. And again, the team's committed to try to not let that slip where it has control, and to make sure that we do what we can to have funds flow by the end of the year to give folks the year, the 2016 year, to implement and tee up.
Great. Thinking about the contracting process, are agencies able to spend against the funds and then use the funds for reimbursement before contracts are finalized, or are the funds intended for things post the award is allocated?
Yep. So we have been working with the contracting councils to figure out whether or not we can build a retroactive date into the contract with respect to what period of time the dollars that flow can be used to reimburse past expenditures. So again, I've been trying as hard as I can to provide as much flexibility there. So I've had conversations with two attorneys, continuing to have those. And when I have a solid answer, read between the lines, I'm not giving up, we'll get back to you.
Great. And then could you just talk a little bit about the approach to determining the allocation award amounts for the agencies?
Yeah, so it needs to be based upon a formula. You know, we've been looking at things like days and other care days and other elements. So some way to distribute across the agencies that's based upon some representative data, care days certainly being part of it, and we're just continuing to look at the right formula and probably thinking about if there's a minimum award that each agency can get to make the grant, you know, reasonable amount from which to do something with. I don't know, Mimi, if you want to add anything to that.
Yeah, no, I think you did a really nice job, Lana. You know, I think we're looking at care days and things like, you know, what's the size and the scope of the agency so that the award distributions are equitable. In addition to the minimum award. And I think, you know, the other thing that we would really, really encourage individual agencies to do is look to their colleagues across the table and think about the potential of pooling funds together so that we can really maximize the use of the dollars.
Great. Thanks, you guys.
I really think, too, that I also want to stress with the question about getting the money out sooner. While I completely appreciate that, part of what we're trying to tee up here is that, an, you know, an efficient use of the money. So part of it is looking at the materials from the assessment survey and the benchmarking. And, you know, the idea here, and this is partly what is coming through in the requirement for a contract process from, you know, the administrative requirements of the state for letting this money out, is that it be used in a way that meets the requirements of the statute and is used most efficiently for those efficiencies, those transition readiness activities. And part of us working through that administrative process here and getting folks comfortable are those two tools. So having those are those tools, so having them be taken into account by you in the application process and in your work plan process is really important.
And just to chime in on the efficiencies, and this leads into the next question, you know, we talked about technology and agencies potentially looking at pooling some of the resources that are made available. So in terms of the timelines, that also takes time as well. So folks will have time to kind of think through what's going to be made available and how the different ways that can be approached. Also, you know, assisted with some of the resources that we'll be making available in terms of guidance and menus of options and those kinds of things. But so with the pooling in mind, are there other areas that foster care agencies could consider pooling their resources around?
Dan, I'm not sure if that's a question to us. I mean, I think really some of the technology needs that will come out of the assessment survey, I think, are kind of one of the more obvious places. And right. I will confess off the bat, I'm not a technology software expert. So hence why we have you, Dan, to help us. So, you know, I think those are some of the obvious areas where folks can think about pooling resources for sort of back office management. I also think it depends on what role do you think you're going to have in a managed care environment, and, you know, are you going to be a provider of services and looking to contract with managed care plans? Are you primarily going to be a voluntary foster care? You know, are you going to, you know, just be using your residual premium or residual per diem in your role as a voluntary foster care agency and providing health as well as providing health home care services? You know, what does your world look like? And then backing that up to the information that you receive from the readiness survey to then make some judgments about how should that money be used and is there a really good avenue for pooling. So, you know, I think it's some work to sit down with your colleagues to talk about resources that, you know, can be pooled. But at the end of the day, it will be the most efficient use of the amount of money that we have to give to folks. So, and again, as you look at the results of your information and you want to collaborate with the state on you know, potential ideas for pooling, we'd be happy to help in any way we can. I mean, I think we just need to be, you know, collectively making sure that it's all a good, efficient use of the dollars.
Right. And just to echo that, you know, we'll talk a lot over the coming months and year about the pooling resources around technology and like the build versus buy that folks will make, and then also just how folks can think about how folks can actually strategically think about that on a collaborative from a collaborative approach, and try to do the most that they can with the resources that are made available, in addition to supporting other systems that are currently in place and how that fits in. One of the things that really stood out to us from the readiness assessment was how a lot of agencies have EHR or electronic billing for some but not all, you know, agency-wide. So it's just something that we're thinking about and how we can best support the agencies as they're thinking through this stuff. So moving on to some of the other questions that have come through. Does OCFS anticipate significant changes to the lien ratios that are now possible for social work, clinical staff, and social work supervisors?
As a result of the introduction of health home care managers into the system, do you think that's the genesis of the question, Dan?
If I were a guessing man, which I am, I would say yes.
Yeah, and I think it's way too soon for us to know that at this point. I think we're still sorting through which agencies intend on becoming health home care management agencies, what that model will look like within the individual agencies, what the impact will be on the foster care system. So at this point, I think it's premature for us to be able to really answer that, but I think it's something we need to very carefully watch and see the implications as we go forward.
Yeah, and that's also an excellent segue into the ask. We put out a survey to the voluntary foster care agencies to answer, I think there's 2 to 3 questions in it. There's still around half of the agencies that haven't responded. It would be really extremely helpful to us if you could respond to that. And that is important for us in our application review process, to figure out which counties that the voluntary foster care agencies serve, as well as whether or not you are contemplating becoming a health home downstream health home care manager. I think we talked about in the April 29th webinar that information is really important both to the application review process as well as how we are working with the map builders of the system to program some of those assignment algorithms that we went through on the this past week, I think it was Monday, the 11th. So if you could, Mimi and I would greatly appreciate your response to that survey.
A question came in about agencies who aren't currently Article 31 or 28 licensed but might be interested in pursuing that in preparation for managed care, and what kind of assistance or guidance might be available to them in terms of moving their applications along. So I would just chime in before Mimi or Lana might have something to add. That is part of the managed care foundations and the business strategy and planning piece that we'll be doing over the summer. We'll help agencies think through and identify some of the key questions and information that you'll want to look at in terms of assessing whether an Article 31 or 28 licensure makes sense. And then in terms of the actual application process, I believe that there's some resources and information laid out on that available through the respective state websites. But we're jotting that down as an aside, as something that we could, you know, do a short presentation on and kind of talk people who aren't quite as familiar with it, just talk them through what that is. And just as a quick aside for HCVS designated providers in New York City, you know, an NPI number was identified as something that, you know, something that they should probably obtain. So we did a short webinar that just outlined, you know, what is an NPI number and then how do you go about getting it and what are the different steps. But Mimi or Lana, did you have anything else to add about agencies who might be interested in Article 31 or 28 licensure.
Yeah, and that was great, Dan. Just, you know, I think the question that's swirling around there is, you know, are there certain instances where the plans would be required to contract with voluntary foster care agencies? And I think that's something we need to continue to work through. You know, I think we've had rules like that, either temporarily or, you know, for a period of time in the transitions to managed care with voluntary with plans contracting with voluntary foster care agencies. And so I get the weight of the question and I get why folks are asking it. So we'll try to lend some clarity around that. I think part of the answer a little bit comes into what does the residual per diem look like and what is it paying for. It's sort of a little bit of a lens into some of those kind of bigger, larger picture scheme about how we think about that issue. And then, as Dan points out, there's just the parallel issue of the business decision about whether or not you want to get licensed to be a 28 or a 31 clinic. And then what those options mean for you as a, you know, provider.
Great. And you just, Lana just mentioned the residual per diems. And then a question came through is what happens to the board in care and Medicaid rate methodologies in relation to that?
So, Mimi, I think you're talking about the board side of the piece that's outside the Medicaid rate that is part of the what do you call it?
The MSAR. Yep.
Thank you. Struggling with the acronym.
Dan, I think you need to add that to your acronym list.
Yeah, no kidding.
That's right.
So nothing happens to the MSAR. We don't anticipate any changes at this point to the methodology associated with setting the maximum state aid rate. But clearly, the implication all has to do with how we set the Medicaid rates. And as referenced many times today, you know, we're building a residual per diem. We've been thinking through the components of that. We've been thinking through how to standardize some things, how to raise the level of care across the foster care system. We've been thinking through how the money will flow. And all those things, you know, are being carefully thought through. There's lots of implications associated with each of those questions. And so we're putting our heads together and thinking through what is in the collective best interest.
Great. A question came through about the award allocation letter that's going out to folks on May 29th, and somebody was asking for a spoiler of what will be specifically contained in that letter ahead of the more in-depth webinar that will be going back over it on the 3rd of June.
Congratulations, Voluntary Foster Care Provider X. Your award will be Y. It was based on a formula of Z. Mimi, anything else? And then probably just some tee up for the process that will come your way. But I think we outlined that a little bit today. I think we're trying to be responsive to your desire just to want to know that number for planning purposes. So we're going to work to get that to you as quickly as we can. And I think that it will pretty much be what is in that letter. I don't know, Mimi, were you thinking anything else?
We really weren't. We were just thinking that folks would really want to know what that number is so that they can start discussing their options with their board of directors, knowing that your budget season is coming right around the corner. So we were trying to be as thoughtful as we could in terms of, you know, how voluntary agencies do their budgeting and planning. So that's really it.
And, you know, in advance of that 29th letter, you will have your benchmarking reports and there will have been the post-webinar to the benchmarking reports. And so that'll be some information that you'll have in the back of your mind in advance of and that you can use to, you know, begin to have those discussions once you see the award amount on the 29th.
Great. We got a question about looking further down the road, so after the awards have been allocated and work plans have been approved, and and people are really diving in on the work. Will aggregate comparative data regarding progress be gathered and published similar to how we have gone through the initial readiness assessments? And so that's a great question for us. And it's something that we talk through. We're not sure in terms of exactly what we'll be doing in terms of a quote unquote post test, just to see how folks have been doing as they've been working and implementing these changes. And then specifically around the work plans, you know, it's a great idea to dive into what folks are doing system-wide, and we'll be reporting back on an aggregate basis just because we know folks are interested in those things, as are we. But, you know, in terms of having folks fill out, like, another survey or just doing, like a formal, you know, aggregate thing, I think the work plans are designed in a way to be flexible to meet the needs of the individual agencies. And so finding, a clean way to aggregate all of that systematically might be a challenge. But definitely appreciate, and we'll do what we can on our end to understand as a system, system-wide and on an aggregate level, like what folks are doing in terms of their work plan and keeping track of that over time. And then again, so there's a direct question about the contract and funding, if contract advances are going to be available. Or if that's something that's still being sorted out.
This is Mimi. I'm not sure what happened to Lana. I think she's answered this question, though, before, which is, you know, she's trying really, really hard to make sure that that's a possibility. She's had several meetings with the contract lawyers on this topic. You know, she's making the arguments with the right people. And so we're trying to provide the maximum flexibility to agencies around the funds.
Thanks,
yeah,
Mimi.
Sorry, Mimi. Thank you. Thanks for answering that. I was trying to get Keith into what is a very cold room, so I left the room for a second. Sorry.
So just flipping through some of the questions that have come through. I apologize if some of them are duplicative. We're getting a lot of questions.
So, Dan, if they're duplicative, maybe what we can do is make sure that we just collect them today and then answer them in the Q&A and post them for folks if you're cycling through a series of duplicative questions.
Yeah, there's a little bit of, there's probably just, we're seeing maybe like two or three additional questions that we haven't covered yet. So let's just take a couple more. And
great.
Then we'll wrap things up and do and then we can capture everything else in the FAQ that's going to be posted next week. So there's a question about LGUs. So how do you see the role of the LGU in supporting agencies in their applications for OASAS and or OMH licenses with the trajectory being towards integrated licensure?
Interesting question.
Yeah.
I don't have an instant reaction to that. Do you, Mimi?
I don't. I guess my instant reaction was one of confusion. I'd like to look at the question and hear more about sort of what's behind the question, how were folks thinking LGUs could be helpful. So maybe whoever posed the question could give us some additional thoughts.
That sounds great. And then, let's see, we talked about the 529 letter and then also handling care coordination for health and activities. Yeah, and I think many of the questions that we're just looking through now that have come in are also kind of, you're asking similar, if not the same things that have been covered already. I think one other thing outside of the pooling, which I think a lot of people are really interested in, so just to acknowledge that off the top, that we see a lot of the questions coming in about pooling resources and what that can look like and what that might look like for folks. And so just to say that that's something that we'll be diving in on a little more deeply, both with the June 3rd follow-up letter after the awards, the award letters go out, and then also just thinking specifically about what's happening over the summer as folks are working on their work plans and some of the work plan TAs. So we'll be sure to have you know, a bit more guidance, and then also some anticipate some robust discussion around what that can look like for folks. So the last thing that's popping up is has there been thought of having connections handle care coordination for health home activities?
No, all of the health home care coordination activities are centrally housed in the Medicaid Analyst Performance Portal. From a practical point of view, there would not be time to create that approach. Down the road, MAP is intended to connect with other systems, both, you know, either through customers accessing MAP or connectivity with the MAP system to other types of systems like connections. But a down the road, longer term goal of MAP. But the health home tracking mechanism needs to be housed in one central place. In the design and build since the inception of the health home program has always envisioned that, and existing health home programs have designed themselves around that as well.
Great. And with that, I think we'll wrap up for the day. So I'd like to just thank off the top Lana and Mimi and Laura for the part she was able to be on for joining and presenting and spending so much time answering, you know, the great questions that were coming through. To thank Harry and IPRO, Adele and John over at NYCCP, and really to thank the over 200 people, 200 participants today, which we also know can sometimes mean more than one person huddled around a computer in a conference room. So we're really excited by the interest and enthusiasm folks have for this initiative. And folks should keep an eye out next week for their agency benchmarking reports, which will be going to the email address that we have on record for the person who submitted the readiness assessment. And then later in the week, the post-webinar FAQ that'll be made available. And then shortly after, award allocation letters, and then please mark the calendar and register when the link is sent around for the June 3rd webinar that will dive a little more deeply into applications and work plan development. So again, really excited to be working with everyone on this. Thanks so much for your time, and we look forward to seeing you all again soon.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.